Actually, I was overtaking every stage. I was overtaking five
minutes. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
You accelerate for 2 seconds, nothing happens, and suddenly. I won the most amount of rallies in Malaysia. I'm among all Malaysian drivers. Very sure it's. That rally was so stressful because it's, you're going to become world champion, you know. And I'm listening to every sound, you know, like, you know, becoming paranoid a bit. What's that sound? What's that sound, you know? But this time, they paid me to drive. The first year I paid them. The second year, then they paid me. Well, obviously, since I was a small kid, I was very interested in cars, but I never heard about rallying until 1930. That's when I discovered rallying. A friend of mine brought a rally video. Those days, you know, the VHS video. He said, "Karam, I'm sure you'd like to watch this video." I said, "Okay, let's watch." And there were four or five friends of us. We were watching. No, Ari Vatanan, idol, of course, was driving this Ford Escort Mark II. You know, it's raining heavily, wipers full speed, and he's flat out, and you know, sideways, and everything. And I said, "Wow. No, that's the way I want to drive now." And I, of course, like I said, never heard of rallying before until I saw that video. And what an exciting video to watch. RAC Rally, 1980 RAC Rally. So when the video was over and I told my friends, I said, "Guys, that's me. That's what I'm going to become. From today onwards, nothing else matters except becoming a rally driver. That's my ambition. I'm going to become a rally driver and I'm going to become world champion. That's my target. So after this, that's it, you know, forget about everything else, forget about when being a pilot, want to be a musician, want to be anything, or forget it, just rally." And I was 18 years old, you know, I got to learn the sport, volunteering towards the local Malaysian Rally Championship, volunteered as an aero planter, marshal, you know, start marshal, flag off marshal, whatever, you know, finish marshal, sweeper car, all these years. And finally, in 1985, they were looking, you know, they came up with this Crestrol Daylight Rally, looking for new talent. One day rally, just a Sunday, not overnight rally, short rally. So Parang Besar is actually an estate, and which is now basically it is Putrajaya. I had no car, but this was my chance. So I told my dad, I said, "Dad, I want to enter this rally, will you lend me your car?" He said, "Yeah, sure, sure, no problem." Because my dad knew I was a good driver, like, I used to drive him around, you know. And he said, "Yeah, okay, go ahead," you know, full support from my father. But it was a Peugeot 404, okay. Anyway, Peugeot 404 is an awesome car, frankly speaking. Superb handling, super suspension, ideal for, and I had the car was standard suspension, was fantastic during the rally I drove. But our problem was we couldn't get rally tyres because it was a 15-inch. And those days tyres were all 14-inch, and you know, they were 185 or 175, and I needed to get a 15-inch 165 size tyre. Went around asking, and then I met this gentleman who was also a former rally driver and co-driver by name of Tony Liao, and he told me, "You go to this company called Bendek in Selayang, they will retread rally tyres for you." So I had to take 6 tyres and go to them. And they say, "Okay, come back after a few days." They put rally thread over the tires that I gave them, and that's how I went. So I had basically 6 tires, 2 spares, lah, you know. And that was my first rally. Unfortunately, we did not finish. We got stuck in the last stage in the mud, trying to overtake another car. Actually, I was overtaking every stage. I was overtaking 5 cars, which is, that means I was 5 minutes faster than the 5th car, you know, that I overtook. Before my first ever rally, 1 week before, okay, Castrol Daylight Rally, I think it was somewhere in early March in 1985, already decided my friend, my close friend was going to be my co-driver. He passed away, Devinder Singh, my late friend, Devinder Singh. Have to test, you know, have to practice, right, driving on gravel roads. So Sunday, we're going to go and practice. And we went to what is now actually is Sunway. Those days, Sunway was just tin mine, you know, bare tin mine area, you know. And I drove for about, I would say about 1 hour, drove, you know, carrying the car, sliding, this and that. pro, I already know the car. I know how the car handles on gravel. I'm we are ready lah.
You did that with the
my father's
rally tracks.
With the rally tires, yeah, with the Chalop tires. But they were anyway. They were very good, huh? The every car starts at 1 minute intervals, and we used to catch up with five cars. So I was overtaking five cars per rally. I can say in the last SS, I caught up with the sixth car, and he refused to let me overtake. So I was very close to him. You know, I'm horning, I'm flashing my lights, I'm blaring the horn. It was a Honda 1.5 Honda Civic. So I was pressuring him, of course, and he lost control. He went straight into a left, slippy left hander. He went straight, and he went and hit the tree. So to avoid him, I went inside here, and I got stuck in the mud. That's it. And the Peugeot being a heavy car, and well, and we tried our best to get it out of the mud. My friend got on and pushed too heavy. Yeah, so that's it. But then, unfortunately, the whole year of 85, I didn't have a car to drive. So in 86, I bought a Datsun 120Y, which was actually a mistake. I got conned buying that car, a former works car, so unreliable. And the former owners, they had crashed the car so many times, they overturned the car. And then I think that car had the nickname by the name of Motorboat. And I asked them, why you call this car Motorboat? And then they say, you don't know, this car has been in the river before. You know, the former owner drove it into the river. So that's why it's called Motorboat, you know. Always kept breaking down. You know, something will fail, the alternator or the brakes will fail, this will fail, that will fail. Like 86, no results at all. You know, just finishing third in class or something like that. So 1987, bought a Ford Escort Mark II. That one we slowly built. My former boss, Mr. K.G. Tan, big thanks to him. Without him, I would not be, you know, honestly, what I have achieved. So I was working for K.G. Tan. We were insurance claim. You know, he sponsored me. So he gave me my first break because he bought the Ford Escort for 500 ringgit. And then he slowly, we used to, you know, buy a camshaft first. Then we had money, we buy one Weber carburetor, modified suspension, our own, you know, we use Volvo springs. So that car started winning. I started winning actually. I started beating even some works drivers in that 1.6 Escort. In 88, I bought a Toyota Corolla XE. I bought it from Howley Auto, 11,000 or something like that. And the XE was actually an ex-works car from Toyota Malaysia. And that car had everything. It had a Yamaha head, you know, a racing head. It had a TRD suspension, a TRD LSD, driving in the 1.6 class, winning. Won the first rally, won the second rally. After the third rally, I got a call from Leon. Dato' Razak, now come and see me. I would like to talk to you. I said, okay. So anyway, 1988, Dato' Razak Daud calls me and come and see me. You have been beating us in the rally, you know, because I will come out first, they will come out second and third. So there are two drivers, you know, Henry Yap and Ron Lim were their drivers at that time. So I said, okay, I will give you one more car. And they gave me a 1.3 Saga lah. That was my first car, 1988. Thanks to Dato' Razak also for, you know, giving me that opportunity. Of course, thank God I was beating them lah in the rallies. And okay. So after that, we were always winning, you know. So I started at 1.3. Then the following year gave me a 1.5. Then they gave me a 1.6 with twin Webers, you know. Then finally, 1992 was the last I drove a front wheel drive for Proton, the Saga Iswara, with a 1.6 fuel injection. And that one, we beat so many guys in their four-wheel drive turbos. Nobody would believe that, you know, oh, that this car is a 1.6 NA, because I would finish, like, you know, third overall, and there are six or seven four-wheel drive cars behind me, you know, and said, wow, this guy, you know. Yeah. So then at 1992, I told Dato, I think it's time you give me four-wheel drive turbo, because I want to win overall now. I don't want just win in the class. Yeah, so 1993, I got the Saga Iswara turbo. And first rally itself, I won, you know, won outright. Yeah, and never looked back since then. Okay, the Iswara four-wheel drive turbo, the Group S Iswara, I think had 400 horsepower. I mean, they were powerful, but they were not as refined as the Group A cars or the Group N cars. But those days, those cars were very hard to drive because they had no anti-lag system. You accelerate, for 2 seconds, nothing happens, and suddenly 400 horsepower is in your face, you know, and it goes like this, you know. Wild horses, But it was so much fun. It was such a wild horse. And I'm very proud to say that I tamed that wild horse and I won many rallies with that car. I mean, my first ever four-wheel drive rally car ever driven this. Group S was basically a car that you did not homologate. Whereas we were not going to build 2,500 Iswara turbo four-wheel drives. You know, we didn't have the resources anyway. So that's why they were Group S. You build only like, you only build four cars. I won the most amount of rallies in Malaysia. I'm among all Malaysian drivers, I've won the most. And I've also won the most championships. Very sure it's 17, but it might be 18 times Malaysian champion now. But 17 times, I'm very sure. Under Perth 2001, when I was doing Asia Pacific and PWR World Championship, I wasn't rallying in Malaysia. So I skipped about 6 years. 2001 to 2007, did not rally in Malaysia. Datu Razak wanted to go and, you know, promote our cars, you know, all over the world. We went to Thailand. I think Henry Yap went 1991 this time, and I went 1992, and Henry was driving the four-wheel drive turbo, and Greg Carr was driving the Iswara turbo as well. After 94, we went to Indonesia, also Iswara turbo four-wheel drive. Then 95, we went back with the Wira. We went to Philippines as well in a Wira, and we won all three years. And then we started going to Australia, New Zealand, China, Japan. Then you had New Caledonia come in as well.
Malaysian driver,
Malaysian mechanics, Malaysian prepared. Felt so proud, you know, when the Malaysian flag is flying and then they play the Negaraku and things like that when you, you know, up on the podium. It was 2001 Rally of Thailand. Datu Razak obviously was there. Chris Mellers from MEM was there. Peter Collinson, he used to run Rallyat UK. I think he introduced Datu to Mr. Chris Mellers in Thailand. The decision was made, okay, we're going to go PWRC. We're going to go WRC in 2002. The three-year project. First year was supposed to be like, you know, a learning year. Second year, you know, you get some results. And the third year, the plan was to win the rally championship. But I won it the first year itself, you know, so yeah. So that was, they were very impressed, they couldn't believe, because the first rally I did was Cyprus. And after the first stage, I was the fastest in the first stage. And my teammate was checking the stage times and he said, Karam, you are fastest by 7 seconds, you're the fastest. He beat the second guy by 7 seconds. So that gave me the motivation, it's okay. I psyched myself up as well, because World Championship, these are the best drivers in the world. I have to up my level. I started going to the gym. Keep myself fit, no alcohol, no nothing. The whole year I never touched a drop of alcohol. I want to become world champion.
China. With a decisive victory in the Shaoguan-based rally, he can wrap up his second straight APRC title, with one round still to come. Then he'll be able to focus totally on his next challenge, winning the world production car title at Rally Australia.
It'd be nice to win here. I mean, you know, one championship in the bag and then go and attack the other one, so I know we can concentrate on Australia.
Sure enough, he goes hard from the start, starting a series of wins that continues all day, allowing him to open up a one-minute lead.
So I told Alan as well, I said, Alan, we got to up our game. Uncle Alan, we call him Uncle Alan, fantastic navigator, good friend of mine. Some call him Master because he, you know, he's a very strict man, but very good. Cyprus, we won. Next rally was Argentina. Came out third, went to Finland, we were lying second, but our turbo failed, lost some time, then the last day caught up and came out third. So I drove two stages with no turbo, then went to Safari, won the Safari rally, went to New Zealand, car broke down now, so we didn't score any points in New Zealand. So going to the final rally in Australia, and all I had to do was finish third. Actually, I was so scared. That time was really stressful for me. That rally was so stressful because it's, you're going to become world champion, you know, or you might just mess up the whole thing and, you know, lose it, right? You might crash the car, or you might, you know, drive too slow or not concentrate. And I'm listening to every sound, you know, like you know, becoming paranoid a bit. What's that sound? What's that sound? You know, because you know they almost became a world champion. So you know, I came out third lah. I needed to come out third. I came out third, and I won the championship. You know. I think when F1 came to Malaysia, the direction switched. Probably main reason was that Eon lost their dealership, their distributorship, for Proton cars. There was no reason for them to promote the cars anymore worldwide, Word just died like that, Petronas Eon rally team. Cannot sell your car anymore, what for? I want to promote your car.
But why Proton is not doing it? Are they not selling it internationally?
I have no idea what is Proton's logic, Of course, motorsport sells, makes a brand, it sells cars. By MEM, together with Dato Razak's, initiative, the WRC was moving towards NA, this S2000 cars were cheaper than WRC cars, but WRC cars became too expensive. I drove once, bro, but the car was crap. The car was totally, first of all, I told him I don't want left-hand drive, I want right-hand drive. But okay, Nama, I said I tried, but the car was crap. It everything failed. Cannot handle. They had track suspension on a rally car. It's a big, 6-speed sequential gearbox. Within the first kilometer, everything went blank. I don't know what gear am I in. Then the car starts stalling. Engine mati. You brake, engine mati. It's so hot, the paint is melting and coming out. Paint is melting, bro. Jagdev told me, Karam, I'm going to die. Because we're inhaling toxic fumes. Jagdev's pace note bag stuck to the fire, the side that running, the, what do you call it? So we had 70 over degrees inside temperature. 2009, Malaysia, Rally of Malaysia, 2009. The steering system was totally wrong. It refused to want to turn. It always wanted to come back straight.
What?
Wrongly set up, total wrong suspension set up, the caster, the camber, everything wrong set up. In 2007-08, my own sponsors. I bought my own car. I bought a Perth car actually. I bought an Evo 3. Drove it for 1 year, very successful. Won. In 2008, I won and gave an Evo 8.
Round number 10, our national hero when it comes to rallying, of course, Karamjit Singh and Jagdev Singh.
Then I drove for Pennzoil for a few years. With R3, I drove locally. I drove 2012, 13, 14, 15. For them in the Asia Pacific, I drove 2 years, 2011 and 12. For 2011, I paid them to drive. Yeah, that was a very expensive year for me. I spent 600,000 ringgit that year. In the following year, 2012, I won again. But this time, they paid me to drive. The first year, I paid them. In the second year, then they paid me. Then they took me as their driver and, as their, yeah. Not much, but they were still paying me. Yeah. Currently, I'm driving now for VX. If I was Prime Minister, I would tell... I started rallying because of Ari Vatanen. In 1994, believe it or not, on my birthday I met him. The drivers who were competing against me, the European drivers, they were sure that I will be very slow or I'll crash the car. I think David Richards, of course, he was there. The Subaru team was there. I would like to give you a test drive in one of our Subarus. People have called me Carlos Singh. Philippines, I'm called Karam Jet. Hong Kong, my Hong Kong friends, they call me the Malay Feiyan. the flying Malaysian that's in Cantonese, I think. Yeah, Malaysia. Yeah.